me try that. That's working. All right. I am sure this is the first time any of us have ever gathered in a parking lot for an Easter service. But I'm glad you're here. Really, really glad. I've missed your faces. And I wish I could come to every car and shake your hand and hug your neck. But I can't do that. But I'm glad that you're here to celebrate the greatest event in the history of mankind, the glorious resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. Thank God he lives this morning. Amidst the darkest, probably the darkest days that most of us have ever lived through in this country. I want to tell you something. God still lives. Jesus is still on the throne. We can still worship him. We can still trust him. And we know that we don't know what holds. But you know what? We know who holds the future. Amen? Amen. Say amen for me. Blow your horn. Amen. 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 Thank you. Yes, we know. We know who he holds tomorrow. In a few minutes, we're going to observe the Lord's Supper. Never done that before like this. Be a little shorter than it normally is, but at least we can do what Jesus asked us to do. The only thing Jesus ever asked us to do for him was the Lord's Supper. When he said, do this in remembrance of me. And we're going to do that this morning, and I hope that's an unusual looking cup that you've got. And we'll use that to observe the Lord's Supper this morning. And again, I'm glad you're here. And I am very, very pleased with the attendance here this morning. We probably have close to 100 people here this morning. And I think that's awesome. Thank God that he's held the rain off for us. And so we're going to move right on. And Ben Maynard's going to come and lead us in prayer. And we will proceed right from there. So Ben, if you will come on. And
there we go. The phrase, honk if you love Jesus, comes to mind. Praise God, we're able to be here this morning. Jesus said, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you, and if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also, and where I go you know, and the way you know. Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you are going, and how can we know the way? Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father except through me. Let us pray. Father, in a troubled time in our nation and in the world, I thank you that we know the way and we know the truth and that we are living the life because we come to the Father through Jesus. And Father, we praise you that we don't have to worry about tomorrow because you've got it in your hands. Father, we would give you thanks for the people that have put their lives on the line and they're working in the face of this trouble, for the hospital workers, the doctors, the EMTs, the firemen, the policemen, the National Guard, all the people that are involved in helping others. And Father, you show us the way that we can be a witness for you during this time. We just want to praise you today and thank you for the gift of eternal life that we have through faith in Jesus Christ. For we pray it in his precious name. Amen.
Turn with me to Matthew chapter 26. Matthew chapter 26. If you do have your Bibles this morning, you definitely can't say that you left them in your car. We're going to read two passages, both about the Lord's Supper. So Matthew 26, beginning. Now as they were eating, Jesus took bread, and after blessing it, broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body." And he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. I tell you, I will not drink again of this fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom." And when they had sung a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. Now turn with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 11. So 1 Corinthians chapter 11, beginning in verse 23, Paul writes, "For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus on the night when he was betrayed took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, he also took the cup after supper, saying, 'This cup in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Whoever therefore eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty concerning the body and blood of the Lord. Let a person examine himself then, and so eat the bread and drink of the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without discerning the body eats and drinks judgment on himself. That is why many of you are weak and ill, and some have died. But if we judged ourselves truly, we would not be judged. But when we are judged by the Lord, we are disciplined so that we may not be condemned along with the world. So then, my brothers, when you come together to eat, wait for one another. If anyone is hungry, let him eat at home, so that when you come together, it will not be for judgment. About the other things, I will give you directions when I come."
The Lord's Supper. You remember they gathered in that upper room to celebrate the Passover, which was something the Jews had done many times. In fact, the Jewish people still celebrate Passover. And all of us know what the Passover, the significance of the Passover was, that God, after 400 years, and according to his promise, he had brought the nation of Israel out of bondage in Egypt. They had no idea that evening that Jesus was going to institute something new. He instituted the Lord's Supper. And Thomas has read that from the Gospel, and Paul gave us a commentary on the Lord's Supper in the book of Corinthians. It's very special to us. As I said a moment ago, it is the only thing that Jesus ever asked us to do for him. When Jesus said, "This do in remembrance of me," you have in your hand a little cup. It's unusual to most of you. It contains both the wafer and the juice. In a moment, I'm going to ask you to peel back that first little layer of plastic, and you'll find a wafer, and we're going to partake of that wafer. The wafer represents the precious, precious body of the Lord Jesus. And what we need to focus on today, and not only today, but we need to focus on it every day of the week. We need to focus on what it means. I, in my pocket, as I said to you this morning, I have in my pocket at least three or four different crosses, different sizes that people have given me through the years. And every time I reach in my pocket, I feel a cross. I'm reminded of the sacrifice Jesus Christ made for me upon the cross. And if you haven't read you two times to take the Gospels, read all four of them, it will take you long. Read the Gospel accounts of how our precious, wonderful suffered for us. These elements remind us of our precious Lord. And so would you just take that, peel that first piece of plastic back, and you'll find there a wafer. Maybe a little hard because it's sealed so that nobody could tamper with it. And so you pull it back, and you'll find that wafer. Maybe you have a little more luck than I have. I should have probably tried this ahead of time. But you have the wafer. And as you know, the wafer, again, represents the body of Jesus. Jesus took a loaf. Jesus took that loaf, and he broke it. And he gave a piece of it to each of his disciples in the upper room that evening. And he said, "This is my body, which is broken for you." And so if you'll take that simple little wafer, it represents the body of the Lord Jesus Christ. And with me, if you will take that this morning, a minute of prayer. We are an extremely blessed people, even in the midst of perhaps the greatest crisis that we've ever endured. Many of our fellow citizens are suffering untold agony, being confined to our homes, unable to meet in our church buildings as we normally would on this morning. But Father, even though we do not have many things, we have the thing this morning that is most important. We have the Lord Jesus Christ. And I'm so thankful this little wafer this morning represents all of us. Broken body of the Lord Jesus, thank you. And Father, we stood in this parking lot all day today. We said nothing but thank you. Thank you, thank you. I heard a song the other day, Father. Can't remember much about it. Don't remember the title. But a part of it just said, "Lord, sometimes I come not to ask you for anything, but I come just to say thank you." That's the way we are this morning, Father, as we think about your broken body on Calvary. Father, we come to just say thank you that you loved us that much. That God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. Whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Father, we thank you for that this morning. And we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, if you'll peel that next little piece of plastic back, you'll find the juice, normally in a different fashion when we do it in the church. But this represents the shed blood of Jesus. Bible says without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sin. I put that old song that says, "What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus." Thank God for Jesus' blood. It was his blood shed on Calvary 2,000 years ago that makes it possible this morning for us to meet here in this place and to know that we're saved, we're redeemed, we're born again, we're children of God, and we're going to meet him again in heaven one day. Oh, this is special. Special, special. Amen and amen. And Father, we thank you for the body. We thank you for the blood that presents our salvation. Thank you that you loved us. Shed every drop of it on Calvary's cross. Bless us this morning as we meet together in an unusual place under different circumstances. But thank you, as I heard someone say just yesterday, where two or three are gathered together in his name, regardless of where they gather, in their homes, in a parking lot, in a church building, it really doesn't matter. When we gather in Jesus' name, we have one great assurance. He is with us today. Amen and amen and amen.
The day after Jesus was crucified, the next day must have dawned gray and sunless. How can we imagine the hopelessness of that Saturday? How can we fathom the despair of a faith that has died? Jesus' followers were either immobilized by grief or hiding in fear. His accusers rushed to seal the tomb more securely, and on that second day, death appeared to have claimed the final victory. What would our world have become if it had all ended that day? What if Sunday had never come?
Sunday did come, and the sun began to rise. Sunday did come, and the stone rolled away. Sunday did come, and the tomb was empty.
Singing that we can.
If you would, take your Bibles now and join me in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. 1 Corinthians chapter 15. We're going to read verses 3 through 5 and then 12 through 23. So 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Paul writes, "For I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the Scriptures, that he was buried and that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas, then to the 12." Verse 12. "Now if Christ is proclaimed as risen from the dead, how can some of you say that there is no resurrection of the dead? But if there is no resurrection of the dead, then not even Christ has been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, then our preaching is in vain and your faith is in vain. We were even found to be misrepresenting God because we testified about God that he raised Christ, whom he did not raise, if it is true that the dead are not raised. For if the dead are not raised, not even Christ has been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile, and you are still in your sins. Then those who have fallen asleep in Christ have perished. If in Christ we have hope in this life only, we are of all people most to be pitied. But in fact, Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. For as by a man came death, by a man has come also the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, so also in Christ shall all be made alive. But each in his own order. Christ the first fruits, then at his coming, those who belong to Christ."
Nothing to say, they just lost their dearest friend. All that he said, now he was dead. So this was the way it would end. The dreams they had dreamed were not what they'd seen. Now that he was dead and gone, the garden, the jail, the hammer, the nail. How could a night be so long?
Then came the morning. Night turned into day. The storm.
Star, the kings from afar, wedding, the water, the wine. Now it was done, they'd taken her son, wasted before his time. He knew it was true, she'd watched him die too, she'd heard them call him just a man. But deep in her heart, she knew from the start, somehow her son would live again.
Then came
Man, if that don't ring your bell, you ain't got a bell. The darkness could not overwhelm the light. Amen? The darkness could not overwhelm the light. One of the things that I have made a practice of doing for I don't know how far back, on Saturdays, I spend a good bit of time just alone, just reflecting how dark that Saturday must have been for those disciples. And this week, as I have reflected, as I did yesterday for a long time, when I reflected on how those followers of Jesus, and I really believe that they went back to the same upper room where Jesus had instituted the Lord's Supper, where they had the Passover. They went back. And I, in some ways, made a parallel between what they were experiencing, what they were feeling, and what so many people in our country, and not, this isn't something that's confined to America. 84 different countries have been assaulted by this virus. And how people are feeling today, how they felt then. Those followers of Jesus, man, they felt defeated. They felt they'd given themselves probably to a mission that had failed. They felt lonely because they no longer had their master with them. They were hopeless. They were hopeless. They were scared. Or they were afraid. If you go and read that, I think you'll see what I have seen through the years. You see, what they were really thinking is that the authorities are coming for us. They're coming after us in the same way that they came after our Master Jesus. They were certain that the authorities knew them. They probably put more than one lock on those doors to protect them. Fearful, hopeless, despondent, depressed. Let me ask you something this morning. Does that not in so many ways describe the nation, the world that we're living in this morning? Friend, I'll tell you something. There are a lot of hopeless people in this world this morning, in this country. And without Jesus, all of us would be hopeless this morning. Then came the morning. We don't have to live hopeless lives. We can live lives of hope. A lot of people are fearful. I heard that in Charlotte alone, over a fourth of the people this past beginning of this month could not even pay their rent. Are they going to have a place to live next month? I saw a line of cars somewhere, and I can't remember exactly where it was, but they were literally lined up for miles. When I tell you they were lined up for miles, they were. And you know what they were doing? They're waiting for their chance to get to the front of the line and be given a small box of groceries. Boy, where's the next box of groceries coming from? Where's next month's rent coming from? Who's going to pay the electrical bill? Who's going to pay the phone bill? And so on and so forth. These followers of Jesus felt much the same way. Hopeless and without hope, without faith and full of fear. Thomas read one of my favorite passages of Scripture on the resurrection from the 15th chapter of from the 15th chapter of 1 Corinthians. That to me is the greatest commentary beside what the Gospels about the resurrection of Jesus. Paul explains it in a very clear way. What if the morning had not come? What if there were no Easter? You know what, folks? We wouldn't be here this morning And Paul enumerated a number of things, and I don't have time because I was not going to keep you a long time. But there are four things. I'm going to pretty much mention them and ask you to think about them today. Don't go home and just watch television. Go home and think today what this day really means. It really means. You know what it means? This day means everything in the world to the child of God. It is everything. Without it, neither would we have faith. Without it, we would be fearful this morning. Without it, we would be hopeless this morning. Without it, looking out over that cemetery, we would have absolutely no hope that one day, Jesus is coming back. And the tombs are going to be opened up. Time, Mom and I go, as we did this past week, to our parents' graves and decorate them. I stand there with tears. 40 years since my mom went home to be with the Lord. 20 something since Mary's mom and dad went home to be with the Lord. Boy, I stand there weeping, thinking about the memories. But you know what? The more I'm thinking about one day, graves are going to open up. And I'm going to see that mom that I haven't seen in 40 years or 50 years, whatever it is. I'm going to see her. That's what the resurrection assures us of this morning. We have hope. If in this world only we have hope, we have all made most miserable. Every time I visit the home where the death angel has come, and if they're Christian, or at most funerals that I conduct today, I repeat a verse of Scripture. We sorrow not. Oh, yes, we weep when our loved ones leave us. But we sorrow not even as others who have no hope. For we know that one day, Jesus is going to come and bring them back to us. Oh, what a day that's going to be. Let me say to you, and let me say to this nation, let me say to this world, we do not have to live faithless. We have faith. We have faith. It really struck me this time when I was reading through all the Gospels, got to the resurrection. And how many times, what did the angel say to the women first? Be not afraid. When Jesus met the women after his resurrection, what did Jesus say? Be not afraid. What did Jesus say? Peace. We don't know what tomorrow holds. We have absolutely no idea what tomorrow holds, or next week, or next year. But I want to tell you something. My faith leads me to believe one thing. My faith leads me to believe that God's still in charge. This virus did not take God by surprise, I promise you that. And God has not gotten off into a corner somewhere in heaven, oblivious to his children here on earth. God is very aware of us this morning. Over in Hebrews, I read the passage the other day, that Jesus can feel our pain. He can sympathize with us. Now, I want to show you this morning, the resurrection of Jesus says to me, he understands. You may be going through a tough time. You may have friends who are going through a tough time. You may have friends who've lost loved ones. Let me tell you something. We can trust God. Through it all, Andre Crouch used to sing, I've learned to trust in Jesus. I've learned to trust in God. Through it all. I'm human as anybody here this morning. I'm just as human as you are. Oh, yeah, sometimes the old devil will creep in with that little tinge of doubt and depression and fear. But, oh, God always brings me back to say, but I know he lives this morning. Let me see if I can find in my pocket. I probably couldn't remember all of it, but I've been singing it this weekend. I serve a risen Savior. He's in the world today. I know that he is living, whatever men may say. I see his hand of mercy. I hear his voice of cheer. And just the time I need him, he's always near. He lives. He lives. He lives. Christ Jesus lives today. Listen to these words. He walks with me. Amen. You know, I was talking to Gene Black, who's a patient at a Chandler Place in Rock Hill, the other day on the phone. And you know, they're totally confined to a little room. Gene Black said to me, you know what gets me through, Ray? I know. I know, Gene said.
Jesus is with me every day, all the day. Hallelujah. Now, if that don't excite you, something wrong with you. Something's wrong with your faith if you can't believe that he's with you. And the rest of it says, he walks with me and talks with me a long life's narrow way. He lives. Salvation to impart. You ask me how I know he lives. How do I know he lives? The very same way that you know he lives this morning. Because he lives in your heart. That's Easter. That's the resurrection. And then I probably should have begun with this, but I sort of left my notes laying there and wanted to speak my heart this morning. You know what? If Jesus had not risen, thank God for Calvary. Thank God for that cross. Thank God for that shed blood. As I said to you many times, I keep a cross in my pocket about all the time. And throughout the day, I'll reach down there and I'll grab that cross. And I'll remind myself what that cross means to me. But let me tell you something. Without the resurrection, that cross would be in vain. That cross would be useless. That cross would be worthless. You see, when God brought Jesus forth from the grave, you know what God was saying? God was saying, I'm putting a great stamp of approval upon my son, who he is. And I'm putting a stamp of approval upon what he has done for you on Calvary. Shed his blood. That's the authentication that God accepted the blood of Jesus for my sins. That's what the resurrection says. And I'm forgiven today, and you're forgiven today, or you can be forgiven today. If you've never trusted Jesus, you can today. You can experience that same forgiveness. You can experience this morning the same eternal life that those in this parking lot have experienced this morning through Jesus. Aren't you glad he lives? Just honk your horn again for me this morning. Amen. Amen. Jesus lives. I promise you that. By this time, hopefully by this time next year. We don't know how long it's going to last. But really, let me tell you, you worship at home. You worship God at work. You worship God wherever you are. Take time to study the word during this time. Take time to pray. Let me tell you a little story real quickly. Let me say a word before I forget it. There are two of our members here this morning, thank God, who recently went through pretty tough surgeries. There's Teddy Bright here behind me, and there's Wanda Wood down here. They had pretty tough surgeries. And folks, I'm going to tell you something. They're here this morning. They're here worshiping with us this morning. We thank God. That's another aspect of the resurrection. He heals. He heals. He heals. He heals. Let me tell you a little story. We're confined. Man, I have claustrophobia, so to speak. I'm not one to like to sit around the house and just stay there and do nothing. This has really confined me and really hurt me that I can't visit the nursing homes and the hospitals and do those things that I have done for over 50 years. It's tough. T-U-double-F on me sometimes. Ask Mama and ask Coco, they'll tell you. It's tough. But I was thinking the other day. When I was pastor in Charleston many, many, many years ago, I was much younger, and I was burning the candle at both ends. I'd been warned, slow down, but I was stubborn, still stubborn, not as much as I was then. Ended up in Roper Hospital. Some of you know where Roper is in Charleston, right near the Medical University Hospital. But ended up in the hospital, never will forget. Deacon of mine brought me a book on the 23rd Psalm. I've got a number of books on the 23rd Psalm, one of my favorites. I don't remember exactly which book it was. I don't remember the author. I don't remember many of the things. In fact, I'm reading again two books on the 23rd Psalm. Read the 23rd Psalm and quote it and quote it and quote it. It'll bless you and it'll help you. In that book, the author said this, "He maketh me to lie down." Boy, it's like a sledgehammer hitting me upside the head. You know what he's saying to me? Sometimes when you're so stubborn, so stupid, that you won't slow down. You know what? Listen to me, beloved, that I love with all my heart. Sometimes God will slow you down. And I thought after thinking about that, it just may be. You know what? God's slowing us Americans down so that we'll take the time to do the things that we should have been doing all along. Praying, reading our Bibles. You know where your faith's coming from? Faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Read the word. Take your church roll. Pray for your fellow church members by name every day. Don't just say, Lord, bless our church. Call out the names. Call out Ken and Joanne. Call out Teddy and Brenda. Call out Andy sitting over here and Bob sitting over here. And call out the names and pray for them. Take time to build your faith in a way that you've never built your faith. And then when the church doors open, you ought to come back with a renewed vengeance and commitment to serve Jesus. And remember, even though we don't gather in that building every Sunday, and I hope that will end soon for you, remember this, the expenses of your church go on. You can mail them, you can drop them by the office, and just remember, Paul said, let every one of you lay by him in stores. God hath prospered him. You have been so good and faithful to come this morning. You have overmet my expectations. As best we can figure, there are about 100 people here this morning. I thank God for you. I love you. If you need me, don't hesitate to pick up the telephone and call me. God bless you. Father, I have been blessed today. My, how this old man's been blessed. Thank you that Steve and Betty could come and join us here this morning in this car that I'm tapping on. Hadn't been able to come inside here this morning. Thank you for them. Thank you for touching Teddy. Thank you for touching Wanda. I could call a lot of names this morning, a lot of people who are very special and precious to this old man. Been a lot to me. And I pray you'd bless them. Father, help us keep the faith. Have faith in God when your pathway is lonely. He sees and knows all the way you have trod. Never the lone of the least of his children. Have faith in God. Have faith in God. God loves you, and you're his child, and he will take care of you. I promise you that. If you need me, call me. I'd like to know sort of over the next few days what you thought of this service. God bless you. Be safe going out of here. Don't run over each other. It's not the racetrack, it's the church parking lot. Amen. God bless you.